You usually won't be asked to do this, but let's derive the moment of inertia for at least one geometry. Then after that, what will usually happen, typically speaking, is that you'll be given a table. And that table will have different geometries and it will have the different equations that correspond to those geometries for the moment of inertia of different situations. But let's go ahead and derive one of them. Okay, so we have this rod. The rod has a total mass, capital M, we're going to let it be, and a total length, capital L. This axis runs right through the middle of it so that this half is L over 2 and this half is capital L over 2. So it's capital L over 2 on both sides. So we remember from previously that the moment of inertia is equal to the sum of the individual components, which we'll label MI, times R sub I squared, right? But we don't want to sum up, you know, billions of atoms, right, at different distances away from the axis. So let's let this be a homogeneous material, all of one density, okay? And so let's let the, some length density, lambda, be equal to mass over the total length, right? So this is a density function for this rod, both of these being constants, obviously. So it's kilograms per meter of the rod. Okay, so then to represent this thing continuously, we can represent it by an integral of r squared times dm, where dm is some small element of the rod. Okay, now dm, but where dm is equal to lambda times dr, right? Because if this is r, and then, you know, a little bit more, a little bit of change in r is dr, so dm is equal to lambda dr, right? Kilograms per meter times meter gives kilograms, so that's the mass of this little bitty element dm. But then let's substitute in for lambda is m over l, the mass density of the rod, so m over l times dr, like so. So coming here, notice that we're going to integrate from 0 out to here. This is L over 2, right? Also, but notice that because we're just doing that for one side of the rod, that the equivalent calculation could be carried out for the other side of the rod. So we're just going to multiply the integral times 2. So 2 times the integral from 0 to L over 2, r squared dm, but now we have dm in terms of dr, so I'll just rewrite dm right there. So m over l times dr, like so. Okay, so then let's factor out the constants, m over l, so we have 2m over l, and then we have the antiderivative of r squared. So the antiderivative of r squared is r cubed over 3. Evaluated from 0 to L over 2. Like so. So this is 2m over L. And then evaluate r cubed at L over 2 and then subtract r cubed over, evaluate r cubed over 3 at L over 2 and then subtract r cubed over 3 evaluated at 0, but this evaluated at 0, this term is just 0. So we just need to evaluate this thing at L over 2 and put that guy right here. So this is L over 2 cubed over 3, right? Okay, so then this is 2m over L, and we have, let's do some, you know, this is L cubed over 2 cubed, and then invert and multiply this 3. So we'll have L cubed over 2 cubed, which is, and I'll just write it in, 2 cubed times 3. Like that. Okay, notice 2 cubed is 8, 8 times 3 is 24, and we have 2 over 24, which reduces to 1/12. So the number is reduced to 1/12, and then this cancels with one of these, so this becomes a 2, and it's 1/12 ml squared. Right? So this is the general procedure that you would go through for deriving the moment of inertia of an object about some axis, okay? All right, see you next time.